Thank you. morning. Let's try it again. Good morning. There you go. Good to see you this morning. Hope everyone is doing well. Welcome to New Life Church, and we are excited. Got a lot of cool things happening today. It's good to have Brother Andy Moore and his family with us today. And he's going to be doing some slides here in just a few moments to update us on the work in Brazil. So we're very, very excited about that. But we are thrilled that you're here, and we are praying that God is going to do something special in our hearts today. And so why don't we give the Lord a prayer and ask his blessing on this service, and then we'll jump right into our worship time. Father, thank you so much for the privilege to be here today. Lord, thank you for the house of God. And I love what the psalmist said, that he was glad when they said. He was thrilled when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. And Lord, I pray that it thrills our soul to gather with the body of Christ. And we pray that right now that you will not just awaken our bodies, but you will awaken our minds and our hearts to be attentive to, Lord, our corporate worship, Lord, to be attentive to the Word of God and how you desire to speak to us today. And so, Lord, anoint every aspect of this service. And we're going to give you praise in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Hey, would you stand with us and let's fellowship for a few moments and shake some hands and we'll come together and worship, okay?
So glad you're with us today in worship this morning. I want you to sing with us, our Lord and Savior, our Majesty, Jesus Christ. Let's start our service today with this song. Join with me as we sing, please. Majesty. Jason Brinson are going to come and go. going to sing our special offertory this morning. Let's ask God's blessing on the offering, please. Brother Danny, would you pray?
Now, Father, Lord, we thank you this day, Lord. We thank you for time, country, and our Lord. Hear your word, Lord. As you do, we pray this morning, we pray in the morning, those of Lord, that is one here today, that doesn't thank you, Lord, as they here today. We can't wait. Lord, as we see this offering, we put us with the good thing.
Go ahead and do it.
Thank you. You may be seated.
He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds, by his wounds we are healed.
He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. Punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds, by his wounds, we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice and the life that you gave. We are healed. For you paid the price. By your grace we are saved. We are saved. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds. By his wounds we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice and the life that you gave. We are healed for you paid the price. By your grace we are saved. We are saved. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, by his wounds, we are healed. By his wounds, by his wounds. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Well, again, it is good to have Brother Andy and Miss Andrea here. A little bit of time this week to spend with them, and so thankful for their work in Brazil and the Lord's work, the part that they play in that. And there is a sense of pride, at least there should be, and I think it's a healthy pride when we can say that Andy Moore is from our church. And some of you had a part in his life. We're not going to say if that was a good part or a bad part. But you had a part of his life, and there is just a sense of pride and ownership and also stewardship, where we have a responsibility. They have some needs in this building project, and that's kind of why they're stateside. And so we want to be a big part of God meeting those needs. He's got some slides and things that he wants to just kind of share in his heart with you for a little few minutes. And so, Brother Andy, you come at this time. Let's give him a new life welcome as he comes.
Morning. excited to be back in Hoover. This is the place where we got our start in ministry, and so good to be back here with you. Appreciate Preacher Scott allowing us to have this time to share about our ministry. We got back into the States Thursday week ago, and so we're still kind of getting acclimated. But it's good to be here. It's good to be back. It's good to see many familiar faces and some new faces. We want to take a few moments this morning just to share a little bit with you about our ministry in Brazil. This is our 15th year in ministry in Brazil. Just doesn't seem possible. It just seemed like yesterday, you know, that we were here, we were talking about Brazil, we were talking about the ministry, and here we are 15 years later. But it's been a great journey. The Lord has blessed you, been faithful. And boy, it's so nice to be here to worship the Lord in English. Because, you know, we take for granted, but that's, you know, it's hard to see, you know, 25 musicians up here. I got one, you know. There's a lot of things that we take for granted here in the States, being in America, having an established church. And I want to tell you something. Anytime you see a church, you need to understand that there's some man of God that poured at least 10 years of his life to get that church on solid foot. Churches just don't happen, folks. And, you know, God calls all of us to play a different role in the Great Commission, but the Lord has put us in a place to start a church and to dig out a church congregation from scratch. And I'm going to tell you what, you appreciate the results of where God can take that down the road once you're involved in building a foundation. We don't have a whole lot of time this morning, but I do just want to share with you 15 years and 10 minutes. You ready? Okay. Every time I look up to the balcony and do like that, that's my clicker, okay? And we're going to click along. I think I need to change the battery, man. There we go. In case any of you, some of you are somewhat familiar with our ministry. I know that you sell pins and needles about every other month to get your Moore's News, you know. I know that's just the highlight of your, you know what Moore's News is, right? Okay. You know, some of you are familiar with our ministry, others not so much. But we're in the southeastern corner of Brazil. You can see up north is the Amazon, up north is the bigger part of Brazil. We're in the southeast corner. We're about 2.5 hours by car from Rio de Janeiro. That's where the Olympics are going to be held next year. That's our little neck of the woods of where we're ministering. And this is our city. This is Juiz de Fora. It's the city of 533,000 people, so just over 500,000 people there. It's a large city. It's a medium city by Brazilian standards. Brazilians are city dwellers. You know, a lot of us as Americans, we have good roads, we have security, we like to be in the country. Brazilians, they like to be in a city dwelling, and so that's where we live. This is the city that we are ministering in. There's 7 universities in our city. And one of our the biggest universities has about 20 to 25,000 students. And so there's a lot of influx of new people coming to our city on a rural basis. This is downtown. This is the main, this is the heart of the city. And anytime you walk on the street, there's anywhere from 2 to 10,000 people on the street. It's kind of overwhelming from somebody from New Bern. You know, it's a big city. It's a large city. There's just a lot of people to reach. And it can be somewhat overwhelming at times. This is where we started. We went to Juiz de Fora. I didn't have enough sense when we started our ministry to go about it like some of these people nowadays do. I mean, they get the team together. They get their dream team. You know, they get their preacher. They get their music guy. They get their discipler. They get their supporting couples. And now we start out with, you know, 25 people. That was our congregation. And I mean, we had services of 7, 6, you know, 2 when the family was sick, you know, I mean, it was rough going. And I mean, hey, we were the, you know, we were the special teacher, the music man, and Brother Scott will tell you that our music program was not existent for a period of time there. I didn't want to go because of the music program. But despite, I mean, we sang the chorus and preached for an hour, you know. But the Lord has been faithful. And after 5.5 years, we finally got an identity in the city. We've got traction. The prayers that we've cried out to God, He sends people Thank the Lord the church was organized in 2013. We have 13 members, and we now have people that are involved in the ministry there, and it's not just our family. One of the main areas that we used to reach out to people were English classes. When you go to a big city like that, people don't know who you are. You weren't invited. They really don't care who you are. But if you can offer them something, especially for free, they value it. And so one of the things that we've been doing for almost 5 years now is offering free English classes to any and everybody. We get the privilege of teaching people how to talk right. Amen. See, me and you got something in common. We're from Newton, North Carolina. We know how to talk right. Okay? And so we get the privilege of teaching Brazilians. A lot of them study English through people from Britain and just have this terrible accent, so we get to help them with that accent a little bit. But through these contacts, we've made inroads into people's lives. And a lot of these students have turned into prospects. We'll be able to do Bible studies with them and see people saved and families get in church through this ministry. This is a fellow that I baptized last year. His name is Lev, and I had a chance to do his wedding just a few months ago, and that's what we're called to do, to make disciples. This is Raquel and Luis Carlos. Luis Carlos is the preacher boy that's in our church, and he's kind of holding the reins, if you will, while we're here in the States. He's been with me for 2 years. He actually lives in our church. He just got a little corner there, and he lives there, and he played. That's our music program, you know. He plays guitar, and he's doing a great job leading while we're here. Rachel was a young lady. Yeah, didn't put it up. Rachel was a young lady that actually went to Southeastern for 6 months. She was one of our first converts, and they're now engaged, and it looks like they're going to be a powerhouse couple for the glory of God to serve the Lord. This is our fifth homecoming, if you will, and we're able to pack the place out. Our largest crowd ever had over 100 people in the bottom level of that apartment building, and so the Lord has done some great things, and we're just really excited about where the Lord is taking us from, where he's taking us to. This is a piece of property that we found in 2011. In the very back, you can see a picture of the mall. And it's a very well-located piece of property. It's 45 feet wide by 60 foot deep and costs $140,000. And the guy's kicking himself for selling to us for so cheap. As I said, Brazilians are city dwellers. Land's a premium. You just about can't find property in our city. But the Lord let us just, a long story, a piece of property. We fed us his will. God provided the funds, and thank the Lord for it. We cleaned off the property. God ready for building, and you keep flipping those slides there. On July 2nd of 2014, we actually broke ground. We dug out the bottom area because you can only build on property one time. And since our property is so small, we had to build up. You can hold right there just a minute. We know the foundation is very important, and we had to spend 3 months doing the foundation work for our church. Our church is a very heavy church, and so we had 18-foot pylons driven down into the ground. We had 92 of them to support the weight of our structure. Then the footers were poured on top of that. So we might be able to go up, you know, a few more stories still. That was foundational work, and, of course, we're right there in the midst of it. This is the garage, and this is what it looks like today. It's unfinished, but it's there, and we're actually going to wait till a later date to finish out the garage to take advantage of the time and resources that we have in the sanctuary. But in the future, we'll make this parking for our church. This is the sanctuary, and you can see them there pouring the concrete and those sorts of things. And that's the way they build Brazil. It's not stick wood in our church. It's all concrete, rebar, and brick. You couldn't burn that thing if you wanted to, amen? We went on, and this is the sanctuary. There's actually four levels to our church. The bottom level is the garage, and then there's the sanctuary, which has a balcony, and then on the top level we have a what we call a high school or open area, and some Sunday school rooms, and our kitchen up there. And you can just kind of see the progression there. Of our churches, you keep flipping through those slides. That's what it looks like today. structure is in place, but it's not completely enclosed. And what they're doing while we're in the States now, they're going around with a layer of stucco on the inside and outside of the floors to prepare the church for the flooring and the final step. You can keep on going there. Just see some of the pictures from the construction. It's been an exciting process to be a part of. You know, it's something the Lord has allowed us to see come about from scratch. And that's our top level there. We're going to have an open area and then our kitchen, thing like that. That's the front. And this is what the church looks like today. It's up. It's there. It just needs, like any lady, it needs a little makeup. Amen. And this is what it's supposed to look like. This is where we're trying to get to, and Lord willing, by the end of the year, we'll be able to be in our church. The Lord has been faithful to us. He's blessed and provided the funding that we've needed, and we have confidence that He's going to help us get in the church this year. Right now, we're kind of facing a difficult situation because we're paying rent on our building, and we're trying to build. And so He's going out two funds. Amen. But as soon as we can get the church far enough along, we can get in our new church and quit paying rent and start investing in the church's future. One exciting thing that has happened these days is that the Brazilian economy has tanked. I don't know if any of you follow the news, but Brazil has had, they have a long-standing history of corruption. They've just never been able to put their finger on it. But their government-run... their government-run gasoline company has sold 1% of their GDP, and now it's come to light, and people are realizing the depths of the problem Brazil has in its economy. But anyway, it's caused the dollar to strengthen against the Brazilian currency. It reached a 12-year high last month. What that means for us is that any time that we're able to bring money to the country now, it goes further than it's ever gone before. Praise God, amen. It's the right time. So what we need is some help to get that building finished. And we are not going to be in the States for a very long time. 90 days is the time of our trip. And we are just really asking people to pray and be sensitive to the Lord's leading in your life and to see if you can help us out to get into this building. I love supporting missions and supporting missionaries, and I love that monthly support, and that's really cool to know that we're partnering with a missionary. But when you can give to a project and know that what you're giving is going directly to buy the concrete, the paint, the rebar, things like that, that's exciting to me to know that you're investing in the work of God. And so we just ask you to pray and search your heart and see what you can do if you can help us by God's grace to get this building. We believe that when we get to this building, really the Lord is going to give us open doors that we've never had before. On the street of the church, there's 1,000 people that live just on the street of the church. And so the opportunities are endless, and we're thankful for what the Lord is doing and is going to do. Please continue to pray for us and do what you can to help us so we can build this building for the glory of God. Thank you.
It's exciting, isn't it? Amen. Keep them in our prayers. Let's continue worshiping. I want to sing this together today. One of my favorite songs. You join with us, will you?
Who can satisfy my soul like you? Who on earth could comfort me and love? Never be more than faithful.
Church, like you mean it, amen. Here we go, out loud. Today. Thank you that you're our sustainer, you're our provider, you're our protector. But most of all, Lord, you're our Savior and our friend. You're the friend that sticketh closer than a brother, and God, we praise your name for that today. That we can turn to you for guidance, for direction, for needs. And Lord, you hear our prayer. Thank you again for the wonderful truth of that song. Thank you for the exciting news that we see out of Brazil. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to bless Brother Andy and Miss Andrew and the kids as they minister in that country. Now, Lord, as we prepare for the hearing and the preaching of your word, God, we pray that our hearts and our minds will be receptive to what you have to say to us this morning. Be with our pastor now as he comes and brings the word to us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Amen. Good to see you this morning. Are you glad to be in God's house? We sure hope so. Take your Bibles and quickly turn to Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4. I am so excited and have been excited for several days now about this message and about the word and the scripture that we have before us. And I want to get right into the message. We'd love to visit with you for a few moments and just tell you about some things God's doing and maybe that in the next service. But God is good. Amen. All the time. And all the time, God is good. And we've heard some messages in days, in recent days, preaching through the book of Revelation, and even Brother Steve's message on Wednesday night, and how we live in a culture where Jesus is profaned, and hopefully none of us are happy about that. I hope that it breaks your heart like it breaks my heart to see the name of my Lord Jesus Christ profaned. It breaks my heart to see our culture diving down into more moral decay. It breaks my heart to know that we have an election coming up, and the election is so uncertain, and the possible candidates before us are really no good for the United States of America. And yet, the Bible says these would be the days. The days are going to last worse and worse. It should not be a surprise to us. And so we know, and I think everyone agrees, that things in our country and in our culture are bad. But things for the Christian are always good. Now, I'm not saying everything's always going good. I'm not saying everything's working out good. But I want you to know something. That the Christian who knows God, who has Jesus Christ as our Savior, our tone of living should be on the upswing. Amen? Because as the world gets worse, the Christian gets closer to the return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, if that doesn't excite you, you have a problem. A big problem. And I would encourage you today from Nehemiah. I have so loved studying personally this book, and God is just in an incredible way to show me things. Sometimes you read the Word of God, and it's like one-dimensional. Sometimes it's just it's words on pages, and that's all. And then sometimes, and you know what I'm talking about, if you study the Word at all, you know that sometimes the Word of God becomes almost like 3D. Where things just kind of stand up in the Word of God. Things just kind of show out. And God begins to just really show you the story as it was. It's more than just words. It becomes real life. And I want to show you some things today that God is showing me from His Word. And I pray that it will be an encouragement to you. Last week, we talked about from Nehemiah chapter number 4. We talked about how Sanballat was asking those questions. And I believe it's five questions that every believer needs to be able to answer. Five questions that every builder must answer. You find them in verse number 2. He says, what do these feeble Jews? He asks the question, will they fortify themselves? He asks the question, will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in a day? Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned? Tobias says, even if they get it built in verse number 3, he says, if a little fox jumps on it, the walls are going to break down. Well, what their building is going to have no lasting quality or value. It's what the enemy says to us. Last week, we talked about how the enemy attacks us. The enemy will attack us personally, those weak people Jews. He will attack our work. Will they fortify themselves? The enemy is going to attack your resolve. Will they sacrifice? The enemy is going to attack your endurance. Will they make an end in a day? Then the enemy really attacks your faith. Will they revive those burned pieces? Will they be able to see God put those things back together and build a wall? That's how the enemy attacks. But by way of introduction, I want us to notice this morning where the enemy will attack. And I believe the enemy has always attacked in the same manner. And I believe the enemy has always aimed at the same spot in your life and mine. We know how the enemy will attack, but where does the enemy attack? And I will submit to you that if Satan can get in your mind, he's got you. Satan will attack your thoughts. He does it right here. In fact, let's read our passage today. The Bible says after they heard these things, in verse number 6, Nehemiah says, so we built the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to work, a mind, a heart. Sometimes in the Old Testament, those words kind of go together. It's talking about the balcony or the stage, rather, of their emotions. It's the seat of their emotions, everything that we are on the inside. They had a heart and a mind to work. Verse 7 says, but it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, those gaps, those vulnerable spots, then they were again very wroth. And they conspire, all of them together, to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Satan wants to attack you, and he wants to hinder your work for God. That's what Satan wants to do. Now, please notice in verse number 8, the enemies had not gotten there. They were just conspiring. But notice the results of just their conspiring. The next verse, Nehemiah says, nevertheless, we made our prayer to God and set a watch against them day and night because of them. Verse 10, and Judah said. Now, up to this point, the affliction had been all the enemy. It had been Sanballat. It had been Tobiah. It had been the Arabians. It had been the Ammonites. The danger or the threat had been on the outside thus far. But notice when there's a threat on the outside, notice how it affects the mind of God's people on the inside. See, the enemy wasn't even there yet, but they were. Notice what Judas said in verse 10. And Judas said to Nehemiah, the strength of the bearers of the burdens is decayed. There is much rubbish so that we are not able to build a wall. And our adversary said, they shall not know neither see till we come in the midst among them and slay them and cause the work to cease. Are you seeing this? Let me notice the next verse. And it came to pass that when the Jews which dwelt by them came, they said unto us 10 times, for all places which ye shall return unto us, they will be upon you. Let me tell you what's happened. The enemy has gotten in their head. The enemy has affected their thinking. I mean, let's just go chronologically through the story. Again, as we do every week, God, Nehemiah hears the word. God deals with Nehemiah. Nehemiah prays. God gives Nehemiah wisdom. Nehemiah goes to the king. The king gives Nehemiah provision. Nehemiah goes to Jerusalem. He gets there. He counts the cost. He scopes out the land. He sees what needs to take place. And then right before chapter 3, he gathers all the people of God together. And he says, you're going to do this, and you're going to do this, and you're going to do this, and we're going to build this thing together. And in chapter 3, we see the people doing the work. And the enemy doesn't like that. The enemy doesn't like the fact that New Life has started 2 services, and we're reaching out to people, and we're reaching out to our community, and we're seeing people say, the enemy doesn't like that. The enemy does not like, ladies and gentlemen, the fact that you're in church today. You understand that? Doesn't like that. The enemy doesn't like the fact that you've got a refound dedication to living God's word. The enemy doesn't like that. The enemy does not like the fact that you're working on your home and working on your relationship with God and working on rearing your children and working on handling your finances faithfully and godly. The enemy does not like that. And the enemy's not going to let you alone. In fact, I wrote down this week, I've been journaling again. Not much of a journaler, or whatever that means. And I wrote down, to think that the world will applaud my effort for God's work is foolish and a misplaced desire. The world is never going to applaud my living for God. Never. And so neither did Sambal, neither did Tobiah, neither did the Ammonites, neither did the Arabians, neither did the Philistines. No time in the history of God's people has the world ever truly applauded their work for God. And so what happened? Sambal gets people together. He first asks questions, and he hears it. It's in earshot of these people. What do these people do? Will they make it into the day? Will they revive the stones? He asks these questions, and he starts planting seeds of discouragement and doubt in the minds of God's people. And yet what did the people do? Chapter 4, verse 6, the people continued to build. And so now Sambal, he broadened his counsel. He went after other enemies of God's people. He went after other enemies of Jerusalem. And so what happened? They came together and they counseled, and the Bible says, they conspired. They put together plans to go to Jerusalem and to take care of this hindrance, to take care of this affliction to them, to take care of this remnant of God's people once and for all. And yet they were not physically there. And yet they were there in the people's minds. Judah and the people of Judah started second guessing. Well, maybe Sambal was right. I mean, did you see that? It's only been a few days since they started working. You remember last week I talked about he's gonna attack you and he's gonna attack your work and then attack your endurance. That first day, it was exciting, man. We were out there working. We were building the wall. We worked 16 hours. And when it was sun up, sun down, we got home. Like, man, what a great day this was. I'm tired, but we did a great job. But the next day when you get up, you're like, wow. Hadn't worked on the sheet gate in a while. You're like, is that how that really worked? Look what he said. And Judas said in verse 10, seeing the strength of the bearers of the burden is decayed. You know what he says to Nehemiah? I know it hasn't been a long time, but we're tired. Can I ask you a question this morning? In working for God and battling against the enemy, have you ever gotten tired? It's okay to be honest. Talked to someone last night on the phone, and I believe one of the knocks on fundamentalism in years past is that we have not established ourselves to be able to be transparent. We want people to think everything's okay. You come to church, you drive into our parking lot, you've got the weight of the world on your shoulders, but as soon as you get out of the car, you want people to think you're walking on water. Right? Am I telling the truth? We don't want to be transparent because we don't want people to think that we're struggling and that we have problems. And by the way, I'm not talking about bellyaching. I'm not talking about murmuring and complaining. I'm not talking about that. But I am talking about being real and being transparent. A dear preacher friend of mine, this week he shared some burdens with me, and he's going through a lot. One of the things he said was, he says, "Scott, I don't like telling people that I'm in such a bad way. He got a bad report from the doctor this past week. He's got some family issues with his daughter's family. Their church has struggled over the last several years with spiritual attacks and financial burdens." He says, "I don't like telling you these things." And through tears, he's being transparent. He's saying, he verbalized to me today, he said, or this week, he said, "I'm not sure how much more I can take." You ever been there? You know what they were saying? They said, "Nehemiah, we know it's only been a couple days, but we're tired." Now, they weren't tired a few days previous, but the enemy started getting in their mind. Will you make an end in the day? Will you have as much passion when you wake up tomorrow for God as you do today? But then they said, "And there's much rubbish. Building new things is exciting. I like to build. I like to frame walls. I like to put up new stuff. I like, you know, doing things new. I don't like cleaning up after old stuff, though, you know? When we did that big remodel in our other building, before we could stand up the new walls, we had to tear down some old ones. Before we could put the new floor in, we had to tear out the old stuff. And that's just a nasty job. And yeah, we're going to build a wall. Oh, that sounds great. But before we completely build it, we got a lot of stuff to clean up. We got a lot of rubbish to get out of the way. And they're thinking now, we've been working several days, and we've been working hard, and we're tired right now, and there's still a lot of rubbish." He said, "We're weary." Nehemiah, there's too much rubbish. We don't know if we have enough to work with here. What else did he say? Verse 11, "And our adversary said," now this isn't Sanballat talking, this isn't Tobiah talking, this isn't the Ammonites talking, this is Judah talking about what Sanballat and Tobiah and the Ammonites said, okay? And he says, "Our adversaries," those people that are against us, "they said, they shall not know, neither see, till we come in the midst among them and slay them." Says, "Nehemiah, we're tired. We don't have much to work with. We can't. There's too much rubbish. We can't build a wall. Nehemiah, they're going to kill us." Listen, that was already in their mind. Nehemiah had convinced them, and how fickle these people could be. Nehemiah had already convinced them. They were charged up. "Let's go build the wall." But as soon as they started having a little bit of adversity, they said, "We're tired. We don't have all to work with. Nehemiah, they're going to kill us." Notice what the men of Jerusalem came and said. "You were hoping they would encourage. But verse 12, it came to pass that when the Jews which dwelt by them came, they said to us, 10 times. They persisted. They said, even, let's see, from all places, 10 times, from all places which ye shall return. Whatever you build, every square inch of this wall, if you build it, they're still going to be upon you. Now listen to the message that's coming to Nehemiah from the inside now, because the enemy got in their mind. He said, Nehemiah, we're tired, we're weary, we can't. Nehemiah's too much trouble, we don't have enough supplies, we can't. Nehemiah, they said they're going to kill us, we can't. Nehemiah, even if we get the wall built, they're not going to leave us alone. Isn't that encouraging? I mean, seriously. Because sometimes that's what we hear from the pulpit. It's bad. It's worse, 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 worse. You know? And it is. And the world's going to continue. And the Antichrist is going to arrive. And things are going to get really, really bad. And people that have arrived in leadership have no business being in leadership. And our country, and our culture, and our world is going to continue to go away from God. And yet I hear from preachers, well, you can't build a church in this day. Your church can't grow. Your church is growing. You're compromising. Really? People in the body of Christ are like, oh, I don't know if we can do this. Dealing with a young man right now who's dealing with a lot. He's got a lot of personal battles. And the truth is, just talking to him as I did this week, just personal battles. This young man said, I know these things are true, but I just don't know if I believe them. You know, understand there's a difference in knowing something and believing something. How many of you know that there's a God? But to believe that that same God is actively involved in my life are two totally different things. In counseling people, there's a lot of defeat. And it always comes from the attacks of the enemy in our mind. They were defeated. And Nehemiah kind of understood that. And so what did he do? Let me do this quickly, okay? Let me give this to you quickly. Look. Verse 13 says, therefore set I in the lower places behind the wall, and on the higher places I even set the people after their families with their swords and their spears and their bows. And I looked and rose up and said to the nobles and the rulers and the rest of the people. And we covered this briefly last week. But notice what Nehemiah said. He said, number one, be not afraid. Take captive those thoughts in your mind. Fear not. Last week we talked about a few instances where the Bible tells us to fear not. We talked about Moses, Pharaoh, one side of the Red Sea, on the other side, he goes to God. What does God tell him? Fear not. Joshua, leading 3 million people and going to God, wanting wisdom. What did God tell him? Fear not. Isaiah chapter 41. What does God tell Isaiah? The prophet, fear not. He told Elisha, fear not. He told Joseph, fear not. Mary, fear not. The shepherds, fear not. Did you know that there are over 100 times in the scriptures where the Bible, in the context of God telling his people in some way, shape, or form, don't fear? 110 times in the Word of God, God tells you, quit being afraid. 110. If God said it once, would it be important? 110 times, God tells every one of you, in whatever situation you're in, whatever you're getting ready to face or are facing, God's telling you, stop being afraid. Take your fear captive. See, can I tell you how important it is to take these things captive in our mind? Quickly, go to Romans chapter 12. When I say quickly, I mean quickly. I'll read verse 1 of Romans chapter 12. while you're turning, and you know it. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service. Love that verse. This is the verse I want you to see. You know this verse just as well. And be not conformed to this world. And I want you to make this parallel today. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed. Then I want you to underline this part if it's not underlined in your Bible. By the renewing of your mind. I want you to understand how important it is for you and for me to be renewed in our mind. Did you know that the Bible here is teaching us that my level of being transformed into God's image on the outside is only going to be equally balanced with my level to be renewed in my mind on the inside. You will only be as outwardly transformed as you are inwardly renewed. God has to be the owner of your mind. He has to renew your mind. He has to create these new thoughts in your mind in order for you to create new actions and to speak new words and to do new things. It's all with the mind. That's why the Apostle Paul said it's so important for you to think on these things. It's why Solomon said in the book of Proverbs that it's so important for us to keep our heart or our mind, again, used interchangeably, with all diligence. Why? Because out of it are all the issues of life. And what was Nehemiah saying? He said, listen, you have got to get a grip. You ever told somebody to do that? Get a grip, man. Get a grip. When the Bible says, fear not, God say, get a grip, dude. Get a hold of yourself. Quit spazzing out. It's not that big a deal. Fear not. That's the first thing he said. Second thing he said in that verse was, remember the Lord. Now you say, well, it's easy for you to say to get a grip. It's easy for you to say, not fear. You know what I'm going through. It's easy for you to say, don't be anxious. Don't worry. You know what I'm going through. Listen to me. Let me tell you why every believer can claim that I'm not going to be afraid no matter what is coming up. Because I can remember God. He said, you mean to help me take some fear away? Get your mind on God. And then he says, the great and awesome God. You want me to tell you what the problem of Judah was? Can I tell you what the problem of these other men in Jerusalem were? I'll tell you what the problem was. That they had their eyes fixed on a big adversary instead of having their eyes fixed on a bigger God. Did you get that? Are you sure? Because I don't know if you're getting it or you're asleep. I love this passage. Quickly turn to 2 Kings chapter 6. I was again. What's funny is in studying for this message early on in the week, and this passage came up at the conference. It was referenced twice, but one of the preacher boys preached on this passage, and I thought, man, this has been, again, a good passage to use to nail this point home. 2 Kings chapter 6, and I've got to hurry. Verse 8 says, and the king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, in such and such place shall we camp. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, saying, beware that thou pass not in such place, for thither the Syrians are come down. And you tell me, what is a greater weapon than the man of God, who God sends a message to the Syrians, the enemies of God, they're setting up camp over there, and they're going to wait for God's people to come. They're waiting for Israel to come so that they can destroy it. And then before they get there, God comes to the man of God and says, Elisha, you probably better warn the host of Israel. And so Elisha, there's no leak. I'm sure the Syrian army's like, man, what happened? It was a perfect place. There's a leak. There's a mole. There's a spy. It wasn't a spy. It was God. And God told Elijah, Elijah, you better go tell the people of Israel, don't go there. Don't come down here, for the Syrians are come down. And the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him and warned him of, and saved himself there, not once nor twice. Therefore, the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. And he called the servants and said to them, will ye not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? There's a spy. Somebody told him, we were in here counseling, we were conspiring, and someone left this meeting, and someone told him where we were going. And it happened multiple times. And the king of Syria said, I want to know. And one of the servants said this, I love this. None, my lord. None, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet that is in Israel, telleth the king of Israel the words that thou speakest. Notice in thy bedchamber. He said, king, because God lives, there's not a place you can go that God's not going to hear you. Isn't that awesome? That ain't the best one. Verse 13. He said, go and spy where he is, and I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, behold, he is in Dothan. Therefore, he sent thither. Now, remember, they're not coming after Israel anymore. They're coming after who? Elijah, you go get him. I'm tired of him spoiling my plans. And therefore, he sent horses and chariots and a great host to get one guy. He sent the whole king kaboom. He sent everyone. Go get him. Go get Elijah. And they came by night, compassed about the city of Dothan. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and went forth, behold, a host compassed about the city. Now listen, he was just going about like any other day. Might be going out to get water. He was just waking up. Might be going to do some prayer time, making some chores. And he comes out, and he's thinking he's going to see countryside. And he does, and he's like, this ain't good. The Bible says there were so many, they compassed about the city. Now, look at this. With horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, alas, my master, how shall we do? Better translated, what shall we do? Can you imagine the fear that gripped the servant? This is the man of God. We've been telling stories on them. We've been telling Israel where Syria's going to be. Now Syria's around us. And the servant goes out. He's like, oh, this is bad. And he runs by the king and says, Elisha, what are we going to do? We're in trouble. This is a big deal. Notice. Verse 16, he answered. I'm sure that servant's like, with all respect I have in me, you're a nutcase, man. There's armies out there. First words. Get a grip, man. Get a grip. For they that be with us, I love it, are more than they that be with them. See, he's like, they that be with us, one, two, are more than probably the thousands of horses and chariots and this great host that's enough to surround the city. Verse 17, and Elisha prayed, said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold. Now, church, get a hold of this. This isn't just a fictitious story. This is a real life event about a God who you and I still serve today. Amen? And he opened his eyes. And he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. Now, did you get that? He goes out, and there's like a single line of soldiers and a host of chariots from Syria. They're all around the city. And then, when he looks back over the shoulder of Elisha, when God opened his eyes, he saw the great and terrible God and all of his armies, and they had filled the mountains. And they just weren't little horses. They were horses and chariots of fire. That's pretty awesome. What did it remind that servant? It reminded him that my God is greater than the God of this world.
Amen.
The armies of heaven are greater than the armies of hell. What was Nehemiah saying? He was saying, get a grip, but open your eyes to how big of a God you serve. See, Satan wants to play games in your mind, ladies and gentlemen, but you serve a much bigger God. Amen? He said, remember the Lord. And then he said, fight. Fight. He said, fight for, back to Nehemiah, he said, fight for your brethren, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your houses. He said, fight. So once you get a grip, once you get these doubts out of your mind, once you get a grip on yourself, once you realize, open your eyes to the amazing size of your God and his armies, and he's great, he's terrible. Then what do you do? Get up and fight. If I went out there to fight by myself, I'm going to be like a servant. I'm like, oh, this is bad. This is going to end quick. But when I know that the host of heaven is on my side, why should I be afraid? Of whom shall I fear? God is on my side. Fast forward to the passage. 60 seconds, I'm going to pray. As soon as they heard this, it was almost like they came back to their senses. The next two verses start with the words, and it came to pass. The results of what Nehemiah said. And what were the results? Man, they went and got some tools, and they went and got a sword. And they put the sword, and they wrapped it around their waist, and they got the tools, and they started working. Half of them worked, and half of them watched. They say, well, there wasn't that many of them, and they're just workers, and they're lay people, and they're average folks. How are they going to fight the armies of the Ammonites and the Arabians and Sambal and Tobiah and all these trained killers? I'll tell you how. They're remembering God now. And Nehemiah said, while you're on the wall and you're separated, when we leave here, you're going to scatter. You're going to go to this side of town. You're going to this side of town. You're going to this workplace. You're going to that workplace. We're on the wall. We're all working. We're all watching. But we're going to be separated. Nehemiah said, I'm going to have a trumpeter beside me. And please don't miss this. I'm going to have a guy with a trumpet. And if I could blow a trumpet, I would have blown it today. Because I'm going to sound this note to you. I'm going to sound the horn to you so that when you leave here, I want this to be ringing in your ears. He said, I'm going to have a trumpeter with me. And you're going to be busy on the wall. You're going to be separated. He said, when we see the enemy, he said, we will blow the trumpet. And he said, when you hear the trumpet, he said, I want you to gather back together. And I want you to hear what he said. Here's my Bible. I lost my Bible. It's bad. But if you will, it came to pass, verse number 17, they which built it on the wall, they which bear the burdens of those that laid, and everyone with his hands wrought the work with the other weapon in the other hand. For the builders, every one of them, had a sword girded by his side, and so they built it, and he sounded the trumpet which was by me. Verse 19, and I said unto the nobles and the rulers and the rest of the people, the work is great and large, we are separated upon the wall, one far from the other. In what place, therefore, ye hear the sound of the trumpet, resort ye thither unto us. And then notice these next words. our God shall fight for us. The body of Christ needs to hear this today, that it is not all doom and gloom when God is on your side. And so if you don't hear anything else I say today, hear this. The trumpet is being blown. And we're gathering together as the body of Christ. And we gather together today to remember one thing. Our God is fighting for us. That tells me three things. I'm not alone. The battle is His, and the victory is mine. Did you hear that? I'm not alone. The battle is His, the victory is mine. Our God will fight. Put that in your mind, ladies and gentlemen. The victory is ours. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for this story, Lord. Thank you for, Lord, how you have overwhelmed my own spirit this week. Because it is so easy to get a little discouraged. It's so easy to get defeated in our minds. Lord, it is so easy to let the enemy just play tricks on us. Get us thinking thoughts we shouldn't think. And Lord, I pray today that the body of Christ is encouraged. Because the victory is ours. So help us to be faithful to fight knowing that. Minister to us today. You're here. Our heads are bowed, eyes are closed. We just got a few moments. But you're here today and you say, Preacher, I'm in the battle. I'm on the battlefield. I know what it's like to get weary. I know what it's like to get tired. I know what it's like for the sea to be a lot of rubbish, too much to do. And I need to be reminded today that I'm not alone. That the battle is the Lord's. The victory is mine already. Maybe today you just need to come and say, Lord, I'm coming today to get a grip. Maybe you need to say, Lord, I'm coming today to open up my eyes and to see the host of heaven in the mountains. Listen to me, whatever it is. Maybe you just want to come today and you just want to say, God, thank you for fighting for me. As we stand to our feet, our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, and many have already come. I wonder this morning if you just want to slip out and join these to say, Lord, the battle's yours. Paul said, I looked to my right, I looked to my left, no man stood with me, but the Lord did. In church, He's promised to never leave or forsake you. If you need to come, this has been such an encouragement to me. I hope it's an encouragement to you. Father, to the best of my ability, I've tried to just give a glimpse to these dear folks on what you've been doing in my heart. I believe I could spend weeks in this one chapter. But I believe the prevailing truth is this, that the enemy is active. And he's attacking, and he's testing, and he's deceiving. But as powerful and as active as he is, he's still no match for my God. So help us today to not be gripped with fear, but help us today to be gripped with faith. Help us today not to be moved by our emotions. God to be fixed on truth. Lord, we sure are thankful today for your presence and your power. Lord, revive our hearts with these truths today. In Jesus' name. All God's people said, hey, I appreciate you being here this first service, and I'm excited about what God's going to be able to do. Let me encourage you to do something. Let me encourage you to come here, and pray for the service, participate. It's okay to smile at 9:30, all right? You lose by about 10:15, you guys start losing up. It's just it's amazing, the difference. But come powered in prayer, and be invited to people. Invite folks. The goal is to grow the body of Christ, to get the gospel to as many people as we can. That's the goal. And I hope that you'll help us with that. Hey, today from 2 to 4, we have our Newton Christian Academy open house. And if you're interested in the school or maybe someone you know is, this would be a great time just to get on campus. And so please come to that. A lot of other announcements are all in your bulletin. And we appreciate you. We love you. Shake a few hands. Consider yourself dismissed. God bless you. Thank you.